Welcome, and thank you for signing in and showing up at the Zoom meeting. I think this is going to be a very special one. And we are in acknowledgement of Black History Month. We have one of our members, Emmalisa Hill. Let me tell you a little bit about Emmalisa. She's going to be introducing the speakers, and she just happens to be the first speaker. So I get to introduce her. And so Emmalisa is a talented, passionate person. She reaches out, she's loving, and she wears the title of Reverend in her church and in our community. And so Emmalisa, I'm so happy to introduce you and to hear what you have prepared for our reading. Emmalisa Hill.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. I have a portrait or a book. It's called Finally Naked that I will be reading from. We couldn't get the poet laureate that we wanted. I think that
it was a little steep on the price, but that's okay.
I think she probably went up too after Super Bowl. I noticed read something for Super Bowl. So she probably doubled by now. But this author is about finally accepting herself at the age of 60. And she'd been hiding and trying to fit in. And the poem that really stuck out for me in her book of poetry was acceptance. Although there are a lot of good things in here, and you can see that cover, and it's nothing like the picture, but it so reveals a lot of inner things about her. So there you are again, your invisibility pulling at me so strong, that deep connection of seeing perfection. Why did I feel something was wrong? Your knock have been gentle nudged, loud bangs, and sometimes cold fog seeping through my pores. Your insurrection is a much deeper connection than I have allowed. I surrender. Sometimes they call you depression. Other times, anguish, sorrow, and pain. But you bring a lesson through my experiences that keep calling out my name. You say I must learn them. And I ask, teach me. I roll out the royal treatment as the alchemy woman I am, preparing to feel my way through blazing hot sand, cold winter nights, autumn's retreat and spring dances, observing from afar the mass of broken pieces, shattered dreams.
My writer's blood.
My religion once was the invisibility of my disvisibility. Adding, multiplying, dividing, and finally subtracting myself. My yes to you was a vibrational match, a sacred key setting off and instantaneously eclipsed, shifting cosmo alignment. Then and only then did I accept your place in the room at the table. You, my instructor, brought the knowledge that joy and pain are equal teachers. In acceptance of your arrival, I swept away the cobwebs of lies, even the lingering doubt that I have to strive, striving to rid you of your voice, striving to rid you of your choice, to choose me as you communicate the essence of my strength. You are a guidepost, a travel map, a new direction. I am open for healing salves of correction. Sometimes it feels as if you are a bully coming too strong, but you whisper my resistance is keeping me from being free. When I finally invite you in, you sit beside happiness, laughter, and poise. Taking your rightful place, you bought on the noise. Your temperament, your rhythm of my life, feels like I am freezing while naked in the winter, or drowning in the bed of hell. Yet I am told that in both, my soul is whispered to. Magic happens in my surrender. I am always the climatization of the acceptance of my own shadow in my light. I thought that was good. That's the end of the one piece of poetry in that book that I wanted to share with you this morning. And it's really a good book of poetry. And I'm not into poetry. I can't write it myself, but I know that the club have a poetry group. So I thought it would be really great to share that. Our next speaker this morning is Roberta Smith. And Roberta Smith, after Roberta is Lorelei. So why don't we just, after Roberta finish, Lorelei just steps in. Because Dwight, you said 3 to 5 minutes. So if I don't talk after each person, that may give us a minute or two.
Yeah, that's good. I just unmuted myself to answer you. Okay. I'm going away again.
Roberta Smith and next Lorelei.
Hi, everybody. I chose something that's a little lighthearted. As everybody knows, I like paranormal things, and this is a paranormal writer. Several years ago, he was a guest speaker at the club, and everybody loved him. His name is E. Van Lowe, and this is a picture of him. And he is a successful author, TV writer, screenwriter, playwright, and producer. He's been nominated for both an Emmy and an Academy Award. And he enjoys writing humorous young adult paranormal stories. So I'm just going to read briefly like a page and a quarter from The Zombie Always Knocks Twice. And to set the scene, it's a story of a 15-year-old girl who lives in Hollywood and she works in a diner that her father co-owns. And she has an agent. Obviously, he writes a lot about Hollywood and TV stuff because that's what he knows because he's in that industry. And she has an agent because that's what her father wants, but she doesn't really want it. So I'll just read a little bit from that. So she's working in the diner. I set the burger and the condiment tray in front of a frumpy looking guy in a grease-stained jumpsuit. "Will that be all, sir?" I said in my most professional voice. He nibbled a fry. "These fries are crispy. I like mine a little soft." "I told you that when I put in my order." He glared at me with accusing eyes. "Yes, you did, sir." I reached onto his plate and picked up a fry. It hung limp between my fingers like a piece of spaghetti. "I think you grabbed the only crispy one on the plate, sir." My voice was filled with professional cheer. "See? The remaining ones are soft like this." The man's mouth dropped open. "Did you just stick your hand in my plate?" "I apologize for that, sir. I was just trying to make a point." He shoved his plate away. "You don't manhandle people's food like that. I don't know where your hands have been." "I know, sir. I'm sorry. I envisioned my entire week's paycheck winging its way out of the diner, through the overcrowded parking lot, and up into Beechwood Canyon, never to be heard from again." Suddenly, my father was by my side. "I got this one, Dimples." He eased me away from the table. "Why don't you grab a menu for the young lady who just sat down over there?" I took several deep breaths as I moved away. I knew better than to touch the customer's food. Customers do not like it when the waitress goes rummaging around in their plates. This was going to cost me. As I whizzed by to grab a menu, Artie tugged at my sleeve. Artie is her agent, okay. "One of the great things about being a TV star is you stick your hand in people's plates, they thank you for it." He winked. Artie was a big winker. Food for thought, I replied. I grabbed a menu off the stack and approached the girl seated in the booth by the door. She was about my age and tiny, but with an athletic build like a gymnast. She had a close haircut, the kind most girls my age would think too daring to try. Her eyes were concealed behind expensive, oversized, dark sunglasses. She was also dead. My breath caught in my throat when I realized it. She looked at me, and a shade slipped down the bridge of her nose, revealing gray-green eyes slowly filling with rage. I put on a smile, but she knew I'd spotted her. "Hi there," I said. She stood up and inched toward the door. "Don't go," I said. "We serve breakfast all day." She took off out the front door, moving with the speed and grace of a gazelle. Oh yeah, there's one more wart on my life I neglected to mention. I'm a necromancer. Roughly speaking, that means I have some kind of special relationship with all things dead. I can spot the dead walking among us, raise the dead, and have a sworn duty to help lay the risen dead back to rest. Bully for me. So that's my contribution. He's a really nice guy. When Mike and I did one of our paranormal conferences, horror fests, he came and all the way from Hollywood and, or Beverly Hills, that's where he lives. And he was one of our readers. He was a guest, so he was really a cool guy. Okay.
That was shocking and awesome. When you said he was also dead, I thought, well, that's a typo, but no, he wasn't.
No, he's a horror writer, but humorous horror writer, so young adult.
By the way, I apologize for the intrusion, but Mike, how do you send a chat message out to everybody? I don't want to do this audibly all the time. Is there a way? Are you there, Mike?
Muting myself. Okay, I'm unmuting myself. You push the button at the bottom of your screen that says chat.
Well, did you expect my computer would have one of those? I don't see it.
Right, should be right in the middle on the bottom. It should say chat. There's a little chat bubble above it.
White's computer is dead.
It's the chat bubble. Okay. Well, I'll just try to be low profile and unassuming. And no, I will not interrupt again. So
I have a suggestion. My chat is at the top of the screen. There are three dots that says more. And if you click on that, the chat drops down.
See, I just hit that, but I had a lot of things drop down, but not chat. So
well, it's to roll
up. I'm sorry for the interruption. Did not mean to do that. I'll just remain silent and take notes. And thank you, Roberta. That was very entertaining. Okay.
Hey, I guess I'm up, huh?
Lorelei, you're up. Sorry for the interruption.
When I was looking for a poem to read for this, I came across a poetry book because I'm kind of into poetry. And the title of it is, excuse me, Hard Times Require Furious Dancing. And I thought, whoa, anyone that can come up with a title like that, that's a book I want to look into. Reminds me a little bit of the title of the one Emilisa wrote. What was the title of that? Getting Naked or something? I thought, you know, those are titles that people are going to just really look into that book.
I got to look at it.
Finally Naked, that was it. Finally Naked, yeah. But Hard Times Require Furious Dancing. I thought, oh, that's really a great title. And that's why I started looking at this author, because of the title of that book. So that might motivate us to make sure we have great titles on our books. And then I selected a poem, and I thought, well, I should look up this Alice Walker. Who's this Alice Walker? Well, she has won a Pulitzer for her fiction, so I guess she should write good titles. She can write good stuff. And she's also the author of The Color Purple. So, oh, okay. One thing I want to tell you before I read this is one thing that kind of sets poetry aside from prose, and it's not rhyming necessarily, because rhyming is almost a little out of style these days. In fact, some competitions won't even accept rhyming poetry. But it's the formatting, the way it's laid out on the page. And this one is really kind of different in that each line, she only has like one, two, or three words on a line. So it runs like three pages just because there's so little on each line. So when I read it, I'm going to do a slight hesitation where she has that break, just because that's the way she wants us to read it. That's the way she wants us to understand what she's saying. So without further ado, Alice's Walker, the title of her poem is, I Will Keep Broken Things. I will keep broken things, the big clay pot with raised iguanas chasing their tails. Two of their wise heads sheared off. I will keep broken things, the old slave market basket brought to my door by Mississippi, a jagged hole gouged in its sturdy, dark oak side. I will keep broken things, the memory of those long, delicious night swims with you. I will keep broken things. In my house, there remains an honored shelf on which I will keep broken things. Their beauty is they need not ever be fixed. I will keep your wild, free laughter, though it is now missing its reassuring and graceful hinge. I will keep broken things. Thank you so much. I will keep broken things. I will keep you, pilgrim of sorrow. I will keep myself. And that's Alice's Walker. I will keep broken things.
That was so great. I'm having so much fun. I'm enjoying this, and we've only had two readers so far. The next two readers would be Mary Thompson and Mike Brewer. Mary?
Yes, thank you for that Alice Walker poem and the other poems. Beautiful. And the horror writer. I'm into pillows these days, and for Christmas I bought myself Continue by Maya Angelou with the poem on the back. Huh. So when I need to, I can pick it up and read it. And it's a nice reminder for all of us during this time of COVID or any hard time to just continue, keep on keeping on, so to speak. And Maya Angelou, we have a history with her with the High Desert World Book Day, where we gave I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings to the prisoners our first or second year. Anyway, this is the poem of the day, Continue. Continue into a world which needed you. My wish for you is that you continue. Continue to be who and how you are, to astonish a mean world with your acts of kindness. Continue to allow humor to lighten the burden of your tender heart. Continue in a society dark with cruelty to let the people hear the grandeur of God in the peals of your laughter. Continue to let your eloquence elevate the people to heights they had only imagined. Continue to remind the people that each is as good as the other and that no one is beneath nor above you. Continue to remember your own young years and look with favor upon the lost and the least and the lonely. Continue to put the mantle of your protection around the bodies of the young and defenseless. Continue to take the hand of the despised and diseased and walk proudly with them in the high street. Some see you and be encouraged to do likewise. Continue to plant a public kiss of concern on the cheek of the sick and the aged and infirm, and count that as a natural action to be expected. Continue to let gratitude be the pillow on which you kneel to say your nightly prayer, and let faith be the bridge you build to overcome evil and welcome good. Continue to ignore no vision which comes to enlarge your range and increase your spirit. Continue to dare to love deeply and risk everything for the good thing. Continue to float happily in the sea of infinite substance which set aside riches for you before you had a name. Continue, and by doing so, you and your work will be able to continue eternally. Thank you.
Muted. I don't hear any of you.
We hear you.
Oh, okay.
I can't hear the music.
Music is second. I didn't get the signal to go ahead, so go ahead.
Yes.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I am so young at 73 that in high school English, we had to read many of the classics, and I chose to read just from the prologue from The Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison. Sort of segues into Emma's Invisible Poet. I am an invisible man. No, I am not a spook like those who haunted Edgar Allan Poe, nor am I one of your Hollywood movie ectoplasms. I am a man of substance, of flesh and bone, fiber and liquids, and I might even be said to possess a mind. I'm invisible, understand, simply because people refuse to see me. Like the bodiless heads you see sometimes in circus sideshows, it is as though I have been surrounded by mirrors of hard, distorting glass. When they approach me, they see only my surroundings, themselves, or figments of their imagination, indeed everything and anything except me. Nor is it my invisibility exactly a matter of biochemical accident to my epidermis. That invisibility to which I refer occurs because of a peculiar disposition of the eyes of those with whom I come in contact, a matter of construction of the inner eyes, those eyes with which they look through their physical eyes upon reality. I am not complaining, nor am I protesting either. It is sometimes advantageous to be unseen, although it is most often rather wearing on the nerves. Then too, you're constantly being bumped up against by those of poor vision. Or again, you often doubt if you really exist. You wonder whether you are simply a phantom in other people's minds. Say, a figure in the nightmare which the sleeper tries with all his strength to destroy. It's when you feel like this out of resentments that you begin to bump people back. Let me confess, you feel that way most of the time. You ache with the need to convince yourself that you do exist in the real world. Okay. And then adding to that, we did our little beta test with Mike before. So this song shouldn't be long. So this song came to mind impulsively when I began to think about Black History Month. First, as a combat squad leader in the Marine Corps in the Vietnam War, I have forever found it difficult to imagine how we could have survived the daily trials of that war without soul music, as it elevated, informed, purged, and soothed the wounds of war. It sang to our soul. Second, this song has relevance to our Writers Club, as it was dismissed, denigrated, and trashed before going to the top of the Billboard charts in 1971, becoming the highest selling song of its time. You just never know where that fourth draft is going to land. Okay, Alexa, play Marvin Gaye's What's Going On.
Here's What's Going On by Marvin Gaye on Amazon Music.
Let's go, Mama, sing it. We'll do a duet. Your husband would have loved this. Very sitting on a bunker at night. There's too many with my
only love can conquer hate. Promise me.
You know, Emma, I can still sing Under the Boardwalk without music with my brother at Marina Reunion. Thank you very much. Next up.
Thank you. That was great. I know that song, love that song. I tried to follow along a little bit. Okay, next up is Alan Reed. And after Alan Reed, Amelia Henson. I guess I said that right.
I'm here, guys.
Hi, Alan.
I chose, well, I'll just give it to you right short. Walter Ellis Mosley was born on January 12, 1952 in Los Angeles, California. He is an American novelist most widely recognized for his crime fiction. In 2020, Mosley received the National Book Foundation Medal for distinguished contribution to American letters, making him the first Black male to receive this honor. He has written more than 50 books, including 15 in the best-selling historical mystery series featuring the hard-boiled detective, Easy Rollins. Rollins is a Black private investigator living in the Watts neighborhood of Los Angeles. The first book in the series published in 1990 was Devil in a Blue Dress, which was made into a feature film starring Denzel Washington. The series also includes Cinnamon Kiss and A Little Yellow Dog, my favorite and the one that I chose to read from today. When I got to work that Monday morning, I knew something was wrong. Mrs. Ida Bell Turner's car was parked in the external lot, and there was a light on in her half of Bungalow C. It was 6:30. The teachers of Sojourner Truth Junior High School never came in that early. Even the janitors who worked under me didn't show up until 7:15. I was a supervising senior head custodian. It was up to me to see that everything worked right. That's why I was almost always the first one on the scene. But not that morning. It was November, and the sky hadn't quite given up night yet. I approached the bungalow feeling a hint of dread. Images of bodies I'd stumble upon in my street life came back to me, but I dismissed them. I was working man, versed in floor waxes and bleach, not blood. The only weapon I carried was a pocket knife, and it only pierced flesh when I cut the corns from my baby toe. I knocked, but nobody answered. Tried my key, but the door was bolted from the inside. Then the damn dog started barking. "Who is it?" a woman's voice called. "It's Mr. Rollins, Mrs. Turler. Is everything okay?" Instead of answering, she fumbled around with the bolt and then pulled the door open. The little yellow dog was yapping, standing on its spindly back legs as if it were going to attack me. But he wasn't going to do a thing. He was hiding behind her blue woolen skirt, making sure that I wouldn't get at him. "Oh, Mr. Rollins," Mrs. Turner said in that breathy voice she had. The adolescent boys of Sojourner Truth took her class just to hear that voice and to see her figure. Mrs. Turner had curves that even a suit of armor couldn't hide. The male teachers at school and the boys' vice principal made it a point to pay their respects at her lunch table in the teacher's cafeteria each day. They didn't say much about her around me, though, because Mrs. Turner was one of the few Negro teachers at a primarily Negro school. The white men had come dim awareness that it would have been insulting for me if I had to hear lewd comments about her. I appreciated their reserve, but I understood what they weren't saying. Mrs. Ida Bell Turner was a knockout for any man, from Cro-Magnon to Jim Crow. "That your dog?" I asked. "Pharaoh," she said to the dog, "quiet now. This is Mr. Rollins. He's a friend." When he heard my name, the dog snarled and bared his teeth. "You know dogs aren't allowed on the property, Mrs. Turner," I said. "I'm supposed..." "Stop that," Pharaoh Ida Bell Turner whined at the dog. She bent down and let him jump into her arms. "Shh, quiet now." She stood up, caressing her little protector. He was the size, but not the pedigree, of a chihuahua. He settled behind down on the breast of her caramel-colored cashmere sweater and growled out curses in dog. "Quiet," Mrs. Turner said. "I'm sorry, Mr. Rollins. I wouldn't have brought him here, but I don't have any choice. I didn't." I could tell by the red rims of her eyelids that she'd been crying. "Well, maybe you could leave in the car," I suggested. Farrell growled again. He was a smart dog. "Oh, no, I couldn't do that. I'd be worried about him suffocating out there. You could crack the window. He's so small, I'm afraid that he'd wiggle out. You know he spends all day at home trying to find me. He loves me, Mr. Rollins. I don't know what to say. Mrs. Call me Ida Bell," she said. "Call me, fool." Mrs. Turner had big brown eyes with fabulously long lashes. Her skin was like rich milk, chocolate, dark, satiny, and smooth. That snarling mutt started looking cute to me. I thought that it wasn't such a problem to have your dog with you. It really wasn't any kind of a health threat. I reached out to make friends with him. He tested my scent and then bit my hand. "Ow, that's it," Ida Bell shouted as if she were talking to a wayward child. "Come on." And that's it. It's one of the best mysteries I have ever read. When I first saw the title, I thought it was a kid's book, and it is not a kid's book. Walter Mosley is a great film noir, you know, writer. I love the old Dashiell Hammett and things like that. So, yeah, that was my choice, and I hope you guys enjoyed it.
Hi. So I've had this book for a long time now, and I just thought this would be a good book to share about slavery and a woman named Harriet Tubman, and she was someone who helped free her own people from slavery. And she also, the person who wrote this book, put in here people who fought back against slavery and the terms for that. So I'm gonna read the prologue for this book, and then I'm going to read some of those terms. No one knows the year exactly in which Harriet Tubman was born. It may have been 1820 or 1821. Almost everyone thought the birth of a slave baby wasn't worth remembering. Born a slave, Harriet Tubman grew into a brave and daring young woman. She was brave enough to escape from slavery. She was daring enough to help others escape too, because she led so many to freedom she was called Moses, like Moses in the Bible. Harriet Tubman believed that her people should be free, and she risked her life many times to help them become free. Even after she had escaped safely from the South, she went back to take other slaves north to freedom. And this is her story. So that's the prologue. And now I'm going to read about like actual slave trades and how they did that. So let me find, here it is. So this is bought and sold. Slaves brought to the United States from Africa were sold at auctions to the person who bid the highest amount of money for them. Groups of Black men, women, and children were brought together for this purpose. Auctions were advertised with signs and newspaper ads. White people came beforehand to look over the slaves. They pried their mouths open to check their teeth. They pinched their arms and legs to test their muscles. Even worse was the way an auction would tear apart a family. A mother might be sold to a plantation owner in Mississippi, while her son or daughter might be sold to a plantation owner in Louisiana. The two would never see each other again. Husbands and wives, parents and children, brothers and sisters were cruelly separated. In 1859, a plantation owner named Pierce M. Butler sold 436 slaves to pay off money he owed. It was the largest slave auction on record in the United States and was called the Weeping Time. Slaves of all whom were born on Butler's plantations were brought to a racetrack in Savannah, Georgia. They were put in stalls meant for horses while they waited for the auction to begin. By the end of the two-day event, all slaves were sold away from the only home they had ever known. They would never see their family or friends again. This part is about people who tried to stop that and realized that slavery is not good. And they are called abolitionists. Yeah. So abolitionists were 18th and 19th century reformers who believed slavery was evil and wanted to end or abolish it. Unlike other anti-slavery supporters who worked toward a gradual end of slavery, abolitionists called for slavery to end immediately. Although Quakers had long opposed slavery, abolitionists were not just Quakers, but people of other religions as well. The abolitionist movement started in 1780 in England, where William Wilberforce and his followers spoke out against the African slave trade. The American abolitionist movement began in 1831, while William Lloyd Garrison started The Liberator, an anti-slavery newspaper in Boston. Other abolitionist newspapers and books followed, but it was not until after the Civil War ended in 1865 that the 13th Amendment outlawing slavery in the United States was passed. And alike abolitionists, Quakers started in England in 1684. Quakers were a Christian religious group founded by George Fox. They got their name because of Fox's demand that they tremble at the word of the Lord. Quakers wore plain clothes and led simple lives. Their passions were few, but were strongly opposed to war. The religion did not allow them to fight. There are still Quakers today who worship in Quaker meeting houses without ministers or priests. Instead, each member of the group is allowed to speak at the meeting. Equality is a very important part of the Quaker way of thinking. Because Quakers were such strong believers in equal rights for all people, they were very opposed to slavery. During the 19th century, many Quakers were also abolitionists. They helped slaves escape and offered their homes, stores, stables, and barns as stations. On the Underground Railroad, they risked their own safety and freedom to help other people who were not free. And these are other people who thought slavery was bad, so they decided to try and stop it as best as they could to help slaves if they were escaping from the South up to the North. So these people set up like stations in the middle of the United States, to the north of the United States, and even parts of Canada, and they were called vigilance committees. As more slaves escaped from the South, vigilance committees sprang up in the larger towns and cities of the North, such as New York, Philadelphia, and Boston. These committees, like the one William Still worked for, raised money to help the runaways. They gave food, shelter, and money to the escaped slaves, who often arrived with torn, filthy clothes, bare feet, and nowhere to go. The members of the vigilance committees also helped runaways settle into communities by giving them letters of recommendation and finding jobs for them. So people who tried to stop slavery, They all had different outlooks on it and different ways of thinking to help stop it, but they all in the end had the same goal to help put an end to slavery. So that's it.
Well, thank you so much. That was really great. We've had some really good stuff this morning. I appreciate everybody participating. I really like the song. We did have some glitches in the sound, but when Mike tested it earlier, we were rocking and we could hear it fine. So maybe one of these Black History Months, we'll have music when we can meet again together. So our next readers are Brittany Majors and Jenny Margada. I was saying Jennifer for a minute. Sorry, Jenny.
Hello. Hello, my name is Brittany Majors. I will be reading a poem that I wrote, and it's called Let the Music Play. But wait, I'm not even drunk yet. Hands on my thigh, can you keep the music playing? The sweet blues that play sour tunes that play out my life. I can't begin to display those emotions because those emotions are void of existence. Just put the track on again. You know, the one where the woman got another woman's heart handed back to her because he forgot their names. Yeah, that track. I need that track to seep into my veins because I'm trapped in a repeat so perpetual, there's no exit to this maze. And my ladder will only reach so high, high enough to chase the rabbit down the same hole that landed me here. Now my new dress is dirty. It was for you, but it doesn't compare to the blood on my hands. Whisper something sweet and pretend you mean it because I can't feel your love, but I want to, so show your love like you're supposed to and forgive in love, but you don't want to. I dance so delicately on broken eggshells. Now my lust is beginning to stain the carpet. Still, I lay down in a bed I made, allowing you to infiltrate the deep. It's okay, I allow it. The sensation brings me alive, and I want it. I need to live again. But for now, in the meantime, in between time, just let the music play. And that's that. Thank you.
Jenny?
I had to get my speaker unmuted.
Okay.
I first became aware of the author Richard Wright when I saw his name on a list of authors for an American literature class assignment in college. The name popped out at me because it has been a family name on my mother's side at least as far back as the mid-1600s. Being something of a hoarder when it comes to writing, I pulled out my old term paper. Here's part of what I wrote about Mr. Wright. Richard Wright was born on September 4th, 1908. His mother was a school teacher, and his father, who abandoned the family soon after Richard was born, was a sharecropper. Richard was raised in a society dominated by racial domination. Jim Crow laws blatantly endorsed segregation, and brutal physical assaults and lynchings were not uncommon. Uncle Tom's Children, a series of essays and short stories published in 1938, became one of the 10 best books of the year. It was acclaimed as marking the beginning of what might be termed modern Black protest literature. And at that time, it was considered to be the most rage-fueled critique of white racism ever to surface in fiction written by Blacks that was intended for a mainstream American audience. Following is an excerpt from The Ethics of Living Jim Crow, an autobiographical sketch, which is the first essay in Uncle Tom's Cabin. My first lesson in how to live as a Negro came when I was quite small. We were living in Arkansas. Our house stood behind the railroad tracks. Its skimpy yard was paved with black cinders. Nothing green ever grew in that yard. The only touch of green we could see was far away, beyond the tracks, over where the white folks lived. but cinders were good enough for me, and I never missed the green growing things. And anyhow, cinders were fine weapons. You could always have a nice hot war with huge black cinders. All you had to do was crouch behind the brick pillars of a house with your hands full of gritty ammunition. And the first woolly black head you saw pop out from behind another row of pillars was your target. You tried your best to knock it off. It was great fun. I never fully realized the appalling disadvantages of a cinder environment until one day the gang to which I belonged found itself engaged in a war with the white boys who lived beyond the tracks. As usual, we laid down our cinder barrage, thinking that this would wipe the white boys out. But they replied with a steady bombardment of broken bottles. We doubled our cinder barrage, but they hid behind trees, hedges, and sloping embankments of their lawns. Having no such fortifications, we retreated to the brick pillars of our homes. During the retreat, a broken milk bottle caught me behind the ear, opening a deep gash which bled profusely. The sight of blood pouring over my face completely demoralized our ranks. My fellow combatants left me standing paralyzed in the center of the yard and scurried for their homes. A kind neighbor saw me and rushed me to a doctor who took 3 stitches in my neck. I sat brooding on my front steps, nursing my wound and waiting for my mother to come home from work. I felt that a grave injustice had been done to me. It was all right to throw cinders. The greatest harm a cinder could do was leave a bruise. But broken bottles were dangerous. They left you cut, bleeding, and helpless. When night fell, my mother came from the white folks' kitchen. I raced down the street to meet her. I could just feel in my bones that she would understand. I knew she would tell me exactly what to do next time. I grabbed her hand and babbled out the story. She examined my wound, then slapped me. "How come you didn't hide?" she asked me. "How come you always fighting?" I was outraged and bawled. Between sobs, I told her that I didn't have any trees or hedges to hide behind. There wasn't a thing I could have used as a trench. And you couldn't throw very far when you were hiding behind the brick pillars of a house. She grabbed a barrel stave, dragged me home, stripped me naked, and beat me till I had a fever of 102. She would smack my rump with the stave, and while the skin was still smarting, impart to me gems of Jim Crow wisdom. I was never to throw cinders anymore. I was never to fight any more wars. I was never, never, under any conditions, to fight white folks again. They were absolutely right in clouding me with a broken milk bottle. Didn't I know she was working hard every day in the hot kitchens of the white folks to make money to take care of me? When was I ever going to learn to be a good boy? She couldn't be bothered with my fights. She finished by telling me that I ought to be thankful to God as long as I lived that they didn't kill me. All that night, I was delirious and could not sleep. Each time I closed my eyes, I saw monstrous white faces suspended from the ceiling, leering at me. From that time on, the charm of my cinder yard was gone. The green trees, the trimmed hedges, the cropped lawns grew very meaningful, became a symbol. Even today, when I think of white folks, the hard, sharp outlines of white houses surrounded by trees, lawns, and hedges are present somewhere in the background of my mind. Through the years, they grew into an overreaching symbol of fear.
Wow.
That's Mr. Wright.
Thank you, Jenny. That was really great. We have Ann Miner, Ava Lynn Morris coming up next. And I see you ready to go.
Are you talking to me?
Yes.
Okay. I've got to get something done. Got to do something with this sound. I'm not sure what's going on.
So. We can hear you.
I know, but I'm getting an echo. Well, I should go to the next one. Go to the next one. I'm getting a terrible echo.
Okay. Aveline.
Mike, are you there?
Is this going to work? Okay. I'm still getting an echo. Keep going. Go to the next one.
Ava Lynn Morse, are you ready to go?
Okay.
Ava Lynn?
Okay, I can.
Ava Lynn. Did she leave, Mike? Barbara Badger. Barbara Badger, are you ready to go?
I am ready.
Okay, would you go next, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
I have here the poem called The Creation by James Weldon Johnson, and he passed in 1938. And God stepped out on space, and he looked around and said, I'm lonely, I'll make me a world. And as far as the eye of God could see, darkness covered everything, blacker than 100 midnights down in a cypress swamp. Then God smiled, and the light broke, and the darkness rolled up on one side, and the light stood shining on the other. And God said, that's good. Then God reached out and took the light in his hands, and he rolled the light around in his hands until he made the sun. And he set that sun a blazing in the heavens, and the light that was left from making that sun, God gathered it up in a shining ball and flung it against the darkness, spangling the night with the moon and stars. Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world. And God said, that's good. Then God himself stepped down, and the sun was on his right hand, and the moon was on his left. The stars were clustered about his head, and the earth was under his feet. And God walked, and where he trod, his footsteps hollowed out the valleys and bulged the mountains up. Then he stopped and looked and saw the earth was hot and barren. So God stepped over to the edge of the world, and he spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes, and the lightnings flashed. He clapped his hands, and the thunders rolled, and the waters above the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. Then the green grass sprouted, and the little red flowers bloomed. The pine tree pointed his finger to the sky. The oak spread out his arms. The lakes cuddled down in the hollows of the ground, and the rivers ran down to the sea. And God smiled again, and the rainbow appeared and curled itself around his shoulder. Then God raised his arm, and he waved his hand over the sea and over the land, and he said, bring forth, bring forth. And quicker than God could drop his hand, fishes and fowls and beasts and birds swam the rivers and the seas, roamed the forests and the woods, and split the air with their wings. And God said, that's good. Then God walked around and looked around on all that he had made. He looked at his sun, he looked at his moon, he looked at his little stars, he looked on his world with all its living things. And God said, I'm lonely still. Then God sat down on the side of a hill where he could think. By a deep, wide river, he sat, with his head in his hands. God thought and thought till he thought, I'll make me a man. From the bed of the river, God scooped the clay. And by the bank of the river, he kneeled him down. And there, the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it in the sky, who flung the stars to the most far corner of the night, who rounded the earth in the middle of his hand, this great God, like a mammy bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust toiling over a lump of clay till he shaped it in his own image. Then into it he blew the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen.
That was great. I remember I had to recite that when I was in the fifth and sixth grade. I still remember bits and pieces of it. So thank you for sharing. Ann Minor, are you ready?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
All right, good, because I don't know what I've got going here. I'm going to read. I scanned the internet and I found something by a woman named Nora Hurst, Neil Hurst, and I'm trying to figure out where the camera is on this iPad. Shoot, I wanted you to be able to see her picture. Look at that. She's got so much personality. There you go. And this is called Dust Tracks on a Road. And she had some people, friends in high places. Ethel Waters was one that she writes about, but she's very, very honest writer. And there's so much in this book that I just wanted to read the entire thing. So if you'll just indulge me a couple of hours, maybe not. Chapter 11 is about books and things, and I thought it would be more, I thought it would be apropos for us. And I'm skipping around, so it might take me a minute. This is on Kindle, and I've never used Kindle, and it's really hard to mark things. But anyway, she says, while I was in the research field in 1929, the idea of Jonas Gourdvine came to me. I had written a few stories, but the idea of attempting a book seemed so big that I gazed at it in the quiet of the night, but hid it away from even myself in daylight. I thought we could all relate to some of this. For one thing, it seemed off key. What I wanted to tell was a story about a man, and from what I had read and heard, Negroes were supposed to write about race and problem. I was and am thoroughly sick of the subject. My interest lies in what makes a man or a woman do such and so, regardless of his color. It seemed to me that the human beings I met reacted pretty much the same to the same stimuli. Different idioms, yes. Circumstances, conditions having power to influence, yes. Inherent difference, no. But I said to myself that that was not what was expected of me, so I was afraid to tell a story the way I wanted, or rather the way the story told itself to me. So I went on that way for 3 years. In May of 1932, the Depression did away with money for research, because that's one of the things she was really doing. So far as I was concerned. So I took my nerve in my hand and decided to try to write the story I had been carrying around in me. Back in my native village, I wrote first Mules and Men. That is, I edited the huge mass of material I had, arranged it in some sequence and laid it aside. It was published after my first novel. Then I wrote a short story called The Gilded Six Bits, which I'll go on from there. And she finally sold her first story that was published in 1933. I rented a house with a bed and a stove in it for $1.50 a week. I paid 2 weeks and then my money ran out. My cousin, Willa Lee Hurston, was working and making $3.50 a week and always gave me the 50 cents to buy groceries with. In about 3 months, I finished the book. Then she had trouble getting it typed. And finally, somebody read it and said, this is going to get published because it's so good. So I'm going to type it for you. And she got it typed, and then she had one to mail it, Western American Express. And it was costing $1.83, and she didn't have that. So she was able to borrow $2 from somebody in October of 1933. And then she... A few days later, she got an acceptance by telegram that they would take her book. And then they offered her a $200 advance. And then she says, I wrote, their eyes were watching God. And she wrote that in Haiti. She traveled all over the world. It was, and I like this part. She said, the story was dammed up in me. And I wrote it under internal pressure in 7 weeks. I wish that I could write it again. In fact, I regret all of my books. It is one of the tragedies of life that one cannot have all the wisdom one is ever to possess in the beginning. Perhaps it's just as well to be rash and foolish for a while. If writers were too wise, perhaps no books would get written at all. It might be better to ask yourself why afterwards than before. Anyway, the force from somewhere in space, which commands you to write in the first place, gives you no choice. You take up the pen when you are told and write what is commanded. There is no agony like bearing an untold story inside you. You've all heard of the Spartan youth with the fox under his cloak. And I'm going to quit there, but she has wonderful, wonderful stories about some of her friends who you might recognize if you're old enough. Famous people, a lot of famous people. And that's Zora Neale Hurston, and I highly recommend her as an author.
All right. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you so much, Anne, Henrietta.
Okay.
Present.
All right. I chose to write a speech by a woman. She was born Isabella Bumfrey, but we know her as Sojourner Truth. Okay. And she was born in 1797, and no one knows what month or what day. So her just, so when you see her, it just says 1797 too, and then they give the date of her death. She was actually a slave, and she ran away in 1826. She ran away, she escaped to freedom with her baby daughter. And then 2 years later, she went to court to fight for her son that had been sold. And she won the case. In fact, she was the first Black woman to win such a case against a white man. She became a women's rights activist and an abolitionist and an evangelist. And in 1851, she went to a women's convention in Akron, Ohio. And the speech is called "Ain't I a Woman?" And it actually wasn't named that. Someone named it that later. Okay. And so I want to read it. Well, the reason they asked why I chose it is because I like women that fight for their rights, you know, and I don't even want to go there. Let me go ahead and do the speech, okay? Because there's a long history about women fighting for rights. And the speech goes, "Well, children, where there is so much racket, there must be something out of kilter. I think that twixt the Negroes of the South and the women at the North, all talking about rights, the white men will be in a fix pretty soon. But what's all this here talking about? That man over there says that women need to be helped into carriages and lifted over ditches and to have the best place everywhere. Nobody ever helps me into carriages or over mud puddles or gives me any best place. And ain't I a woman? Look at me, look at my arm. I have plowed and planted and gathered into barns and no man could help me. And ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I can get it and bear the lash as well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen most all sold off to slavery. And when I cried out with my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman? Then they talk about this thing in the head. What's this they call it? Oh yeah, intellect. That's it, honey. What's that got to do with women's rights or Negroes' rights? If my cup won't hold but a pint and yours holds a quart, wouldn't you be mean to let me have my little half measure full? Not to let me have my little half full. Then that little man in black there, he says women can't have as much rights as men because Christ wasn't a woman. Where did your Christ come from? Where did your Christ come from? From God and a woman. Man had nothing to do with him. if the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, these women together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again. And now they is asking to do it, and the men better let them. Obliged to you for hearing me. And now old Sojourner ain't got nothing more to say.
That was really great. Thank you.
Henrietta, I'm interrupting again. I'm sorry. But whoever named that afterwards was just perfect, just right. Okay. It's exactly what it should have been called. Yeah, thank you.
I remember that piece when I was in elementary school. Whew, a lot of good stuff. Thank you, Henrietta. Next, we have Freddie Gold, and following Freddie Gold is Joe. I see Peg also. So both, one of them follow Freddie, please.
Okay. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I would like to, give a little introduction to this and tell you that in the early 1800s, my great-great-great-grandmother was torn from the Ivory Coast of Africa, and she was carried in a slave ship to the island of St. Croix, where she was sold to a sugarcane plantation owner. After a while, she met a ship's chandler who was Jewish and of French descent and got married and eventually gave birth to my great-great-grandmother, who married a German man, and eventually in the early 20s, they moved to New York. When I first started in the club, I was doing genealogy, and I was on Ancestry, and I was contacted by a man named by Anthony Robert Allen. And it turned out that in his message to me, he said, "I just want you to know that your great grandparents are buried in a cemetery near to my home." Well, it turned out that his great aunt was my great great grandmother. So we were related to one another. I also found out that he was writing his first book, and it was part of a series called, called Slavery and Beyond, detailing with being Black in everyday life and during tumultuous times, beginning in the Caribbean and based on our ancestors. So today I'm going to be reading from his fourth book in the series. It's called Living in the Middle, and it takes place in Tulsa, Oklahoma in 1921. So for anyone who's not familiar with the area, the Greenwood District in Tulsa, this was a thriving Black community. It was called Black Wall Street. They were so successful economically and as a community. But in that very same year, 300 people were killed and 8,000 or more were left homeless when they burned down the entire district of Greenwood in Tulsa, Oklahoma. So this story is about a man named Jimmy Montgomery III. He was a young man who was growing up with his adopted wealthy white mother. She was a very cold woman with old New York money among the Manhattan elite. After graduating from Columbia University, Jimmy realizes that his upbringing doesn't reflect the rest of the world as he's been taught. He sets out to find his roots and his mother of origin, Gloria, in Tulsa, Oklahoma. He's a huge man, almost 7 feet tall, very handsome, and considered mulatto. He's not accepted by the Black and he's not accepted by the white. But he makes the choice to identify as colored and settles in Greenwood, Oklahoma, to do business as a certified public accountant. He meets a man, O.W. Gurley, a founder of Greenwood and prominent owner of a main hotel there, and that man takes him under his wing. So this is a short reading that takes place soon after he arrives, and it's called Promenading. The lobby of the Gurley Hotel busted at its seams. Guests congregated and planned their routes for the promenade, while others came in from the street for a quick bite before the night's festivities. Inside was nothing more than the staging area. All the action took place in deep Greenwood, where Greenwood Avenue intersected with Arthur Street. The celebration of Maid's Night Off every Thursday was the longest standing custom O.W. Gurley could recall. The main event, the Thursday night promenade, involved a casual stroll through the heart of downtown. Gurley greeted his young boarder. "Jimmy, are you ready for the unique experience I promised you?" "I think so, but given that I don't know what it is, I can't say for sure." "Well, let's ask our front desk clerk, Mabel. Come over here, Mabel. Would you say our esteemed guest is wearing his best suit?" "He's one dapper man, Mr. Gurley. And as fine as he's dressed tonight, there's no telling if he's got more where that came from." Jimmy straightened his collar. "Thank you. I think I do my best in this jacket. Happy you like it." Gurley jumped in. "Oh, yes. He's ready. He looks and flirts good, which are the two most important skills for the night. Watch out, folks. New York is about to promenade in deep Greenwood." Once outside, Jimmy took in the magnitude of the event. Dozens of men and women of all ages filled the streets. Greenwood Avenue was not the path. It was the venue. The collection of women and men dressed in their Sunday finest was something to behold. O.W. Gurley made brief introductions for Jimmy without offering much of an explanation to anyone. He'd already spoken to Glory Turner and arranged a get-together the next morning. Jimmy tapped O.W. on the shoulder. "Who is that beautiful woman in that long white dress across the street?" "Ah, I see you have great taste. That's Mercy Brown. Her husband died fighting in the war. She has a child and teaches over at Booker T. Washington School. Do you want an introduction?" "Yes, sir. Follow me." The two men walked across the street, and try as he might, Jimmy couldn't stop himself from staring at the beautiful woman with dimples that flashed on both sides. She looked up and caught his eye, but he still didn't look away. O.W. waited for her to finish her conversation before interrupting. "Mercy, my dear, how are you? This is James Montgomery from New York." "I'm well, thank you." "Nice to meet you, Mr. Montgomery." Someone motioned to O.W. from down the block and he excused himself. "I'll leave you two to chat." "Miss Brown, so nice to make your acquaintance." She offered her hand. "I'm not a young girl living with my parents, Mr. Montgomery. I'm sure you'll meet quite a few of those this evening. I'm a widow with a child, and Brown is my married name. It doesn't feel right using the word miss in front of it. Perhaps we can resolve the issue entirely. If you called me Jimmy, I might call you Mercy. How does that sound? Aren't you the big New York man? Is it the smooth talk or just the idea of New York alone that should make me swoon like all these young girls?" He blushed. "So you notice me?" "Don't make too much of it, Mr. Montgomery. We don't have so many strangers in town joining us for our Thursday night promenade being escorted by O.W. Gurley himself. Curious is all." Loud screaming interrupted on a side street, and Jimmy turned his attention to the noise. Several young men spilled out of a storefront in an obviously drunken state. Jimmy turned to Mercy and raised his eyebrows. "No need to worry, Mr. Montgomery. Most of us are prancing around in our best outfits, but some others like Thursday night to fill their belly with chalk." "Chalk? You've got a lot to learn about Oklahoma. Chalk is short for Choctaw root beer, kind of milky, a white drink. In any case, it was a pleasure meeting you and good evening." Mercy Brown turned and left. She was soon replaced by three girls in their teens who offered invitations for Sunday lunch and personal tours of the neighborhood. But Jimmy's mind remained on the fascinating school teacher. While her reception was not the warmest of the evening, Jimmy hoped he would run into her again in the near future. "Jimmy, over here," O.W. called from a few feet away. "Let's take a break from the girls, my young friend. I'd like to introduce you to some of our most influential business people." Jimmy made his way over to the group of men who congregated in a circle smoking cigars. O.W. made the introductions. "This is John Stratford, the owner of the other hotel." "Notice I said other?" The men laughed. "The fellow to his left is O.B. Mann. His family owns the Mann Brothers grocery store, and he's a war hero who experienced serious combat in Europe. Doesn't talk about it much. Hell, he doesn't talk much at all. I'm also guessing he's the only other person in town who's about your size. Gentlemen, this is Jimmy Montgomery from New York, a Columbia graduate who claims to just be visiting, but I'm hoping we can convince him to stay." Jimmy shook each man's hand. O.W. Gurley spotted Dr. Andrew Jackson and his wife, Julia, moving quickly through the crowd. "Dr. Jackson, a moment of your time. I would like to introduce Jimmy Montgomery from New York. He's here on a visit." "So nice to meet you, Mr. Montgomery." The men shook hands and the doctor's wife offered a smile. "The pleasure is all mine," Jimmy responded. "So sorry we can't stay and chat, but we're running late for a movie at the Dreamland Theater. Welcome to Greenwood. Good to see you as well, O.W. Gurley leaned into Jimmy and explained, "Dr. Jackson is perhaps the finest Black surgeon in the country, and he's a product of Greenwood." "Quite an impressive group, O.W., but I think I'll wander around a bit on my own for a while. Thanks so much for the introductions." Later that evening, Jimmy reflected on the great sense of community that pervaded these few dozen streets housing 10,000 or so residents. The tracks may separate the Blacks from the whites, Jimmy thought, but they don't separate the haves from the have-nots. That's so unusual. Greenwood was a one-of-a-kind place. Whether this would turn out to be a short visit or something much more, Jimmy was glad he'd made the trip. He was meeting with his mother in the morning, and that would determine the length of his stay. He tried to focus his mind on that, but it kept circling around to the lovely Mercy Brown. He went to sleep with a smile on his face.
Woo, that was great. Thank you so much, Freddie. I appreciate that. Mike, I just sent you a message. Would you let the author of a book I read join us for a few minutes? So I will introduce her after she gets in. And next we have up is Joe. Is it Joe Pawlak? P-A-W-L-A-K?
Yes.
All right. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for inviting me. It's an honor. I have two selections here, short. One is called Compared to What? And musicians make very good poets. And this goes back to well over 50 years. And it might be appropriate even today. Love the lie and lie the love. Hanging on with a push and shove. Possession is the motivation that is hanging up the goddamn nation. Looks like we always end up in a rut, everybody now. Trying to make it real, compared to what? Slaughterhouse is killing hogs. Twisted children killing frogs. Poor dumb rednecks rolling logs. Tired old ladies kissing dogs. Hate the human, love the stinking mutt. I can't stand it. Try to make it real, compared to what? The president, he's got his war. Folks don't know just what it's for. Nobody gives us rhyme or reason. Have one doubt, they call it treason. We're chicken feathers, all without one gut, God damn it. Trying to make it real, compared to what? Church on Sunday, sleep and nod, trying to duck the wrath of God. Preachers filling us with fright, trying to tell us what he thinks is right. He really got to be some kind of nut. I can't use it. Trying to make it real, compared to what? Where's that bee and where's that honey? Where's my God and where's my money? Unreal values, crass distortion, unwed mothers need abortion. Kind of brings to mind old young King Tut. He did it now. Tried to make it real, compared to what? The other one is, excuse me, goes back to the late 50s, early 60s. My favorite singer, one of mine, Oscar Brown Jr., sang a song that is so lyric, the words are not enough. Words with notes make for an excellent poem, I think. Anyway, it was written by Mungo Santa Maria, and it's called Afro Blue. Dream of a land my soul is from. I hear a hand stroke on a drum. Shades of delight, cocoa hue, rich as a night, Afro Blue. Elegant boy, beautiful girl, dancing for joy, delicate whirl, shades of delight, cocoa hue, rich as a night, Afro Blue. Two young lovers are face to face with undulating grace. They gently sway, then slip away to some secluded place. Shades of delight, cocoa hue, rich as a night, Afro Blue. Whispering trees echo their sighs, passionate pleas, tender replies. Shades of delight, cocoa hue, rich as a night, Afro Blue. Lovers on flight, upward they glide, burst at the height, slowly subside. Shades of delight, cocoa hue, rich as a night, Afro Blue. And my slumbering fantasy assumes reality until it seems it's not a dream. The two are you and me. Shades of delight, cocoa hue, rich as a night, Afro Blue. Shades of delight, cocoa hue, rich as a night, Afro Blue. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was great. I see that we have the author of the book, Finally Naked, with us. Dwight, do you mind if I introduce her for a minute?
And go right ahead, sure.
Thank you. And then after she finished, hello, Teresa, how are you?
I am well. How are you?
Wonderful. That's Teresa, that's the author of this book, Finally Naked, Book of Poetry. I read that awesome poem, Acceptance. And Teresa, do you want to tell us how you came about just writing this for a few minutes? We are coming to the close of the meeting, but I did want them to meet you. Thank you for joining.
You're welcome, and it's Tressa. And do you want to know how the poem or the book?
The book.
Okay, so a lot of, you know, it actually was kind of subconsciously writing itself. I started, poems just started kind of coming to me, and maybe a year later I realized that they all were talking about a space and time in my life where I was had been experiencing something, where I had worked through it. And so that's the best way I know how to say it. I just looked up one day and realized all these poems were talking about spaces and time in my life that I had overcome, or things that happened, or places where I was experiencing my life in a different way that I had experienced it before. So, yeah.
Okay.
We really, any questions, anybody, before we move on to Dwight? I know she just kind of popped in. I didn't know if she was coming or not. So,
yes.
Well, Tressa, let me just say welcome to this meeting. Nice to meet the author of that book. Very, very nice to have you.
Thank you.
Can I just jump in and say something here, please? If we could get a photograph of her, that would be great for our ink slinger. I don't know how to do it, but if Mike Apodaca could get a picture of her, that would be great.
Okay. I don't know how to do it, Tressa. Can you get us a picture?
A picture of me. I would probably have to send it to you when you share it, because okay. I'm not sure how to take it here. And I'm just coming off work, so I'm kind of coming in late. But thank y'all for inviting me. I can send you a picture.
Okay. I can forward it to Dwight, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yep, very good.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to read a portion of a book by Frederick Douglass entitled My Bondage and My Freedom. Frederick Douglass was born, it is believed, around 1817. And he was born in the east side of Maryland in Talbot County in a little district. They call it a district, not even a town, but the district is known as Tuckahoe. And the name was devised supposedly because somebody would walk into that area, through that area, and they'd see a hoe lying on the ground and they'd just tuck it under their arm and keep going. And that's the way it kind of worked in that area. But this is on the occasion of one of his so-called owners or masters has passed away. And now the goods have to be distributed to heirs and so forth. So here's where we're at. Now, all the property of my old master, slaves included, was in the hands of strangers. Strangers who had nothing to do in accumulating it. Not a slave was left free. All remained slaves from the youngest to the oldest. In any one thing, or if any one thing in my experience, more than another, served to deepen my conviction of the infernal character of slavery and to fill me with unutterable loathing of slaveholders. It was their base ingratitude toward my poor old grandmother. She had served my old master faithfully from youth to old age. She had been the source of all of his wealth. She had peopled his plantation with slaves. She had become a great grandmother in his service. She had rocked him in infancy, attended him in childhood, served him through life, and at his death wiped from his icy brow the cold death sweat and closed his eyes forever. She was nevertheless left a slave for life, a slave in the hands of strangers. And in their hands, she saw her children, her grandchildren, and her great-grandchildren divided like so many sheep, without being gratified with the small privilege of a single word as to their or her own destiny. And to cap the climax of their base ingratitude and fiendish barbarity, my grandmother, who was now very old, having outlived my old master and all his children, have seen the beginning and the end of all of them, and her present owners finding she was but of little value, her frame already racked with the pains of old age, and complete helplessness fast stealing over her once active limbs. They took her into the woods, built her a little hut, put up a little mud chimney, and then made her welcome to the privilege of supporting herself there in perfect loneliness, thus virtually turning her out to die. If my poor old grandmother now lives, she lives to suffer in utter loneliness. She lives to remember and mourn over the loss of children, the loss of grandchildren, and the loss of great-grandchildren. Another part of the book deals with the yearning for freedom. And most slaves, I would imagine, and from what I've read, sought freedom if they could attain it. It was their dream. And so Frederick Douglass writes this: "The flight was a bold and perilous one, but here I am in the great city of New York, safe and sound, without loss of blood or bone. In less than a week after leaving Baltimore, I was walking amid the hurrying throng and gazing upon the dazzling wonders of Broadway. The dreams of my childhood and the purposes of my manhood were now fulfilled. A free state around me and a free earth under my feet. What a moment was this to me. A whole year was pressed into a single day. A new world burst upon my agitated vision. I have often been asked by kind friends to whom I have told my story how I felt when first I found myself beyond the limits of slavery. And I must say here, as I have often said to them, there is scarcely anything about which I could not give a more satisfactory answer. It was a moment of joyous excitement, which no words can describe. In a letter to a friend written soon after reaching New York, I said I felt as one might be supposed to feel on escaping from a den of hungry lions. But in a moment like that, sensations are too intense and too rapid for words. Anguish and grief, like darkness and rain, may be described, but joy and gladness, like the rainbow of promise, defy alike the pen and pencil. For 10 or 15 years, I had been dragging a heavy chain with a huge block attached to it, cumbering my every motion. I had felt myself doomed to drag this chain and this block through life. All efforts beyond or before to separate myself from the hateful encumbrance had only seemed to rivet me more firmly to it. Baffled and discouraged at times, I had asked myself the question, may not this, after all, be God's work? May he not for wise ends have doomed me to this lot? A contest had been going on in my mind for years between the clear consciousness of right and the plausible errors of superstition, between the wisdom of manly courage and the foolish weakness of timidity. The contest was now ended. The chain was severed. God and right stood vindicated. I was a free man, and the voice of peace and joy thrilled my heart." I have to share with you a little of the perceptions of Frederick Douglass. Obviously, this man got some training in writing and in speaking, and in speaking before an audience. And he distinguished himself as he continued to educate himself. And there was, it was very brief, but this is reported by one of the editors of this book. He says, the most remarkable mental phenomenon in Mr. Douglas is his style in writing and speaking. In March 1855, middle of the 19th century, he delivered an address in the Assembly Chamber before the members of the legislature of the state of New York. An eyewitness describes the crowded and most intelligent audience and their rapt attention to the speaker as the grandest scene ever witnessed in the Capitol. Among those whose eyes were riveted on the speaker for a full 2 hours and a half were Thurlow Weed and Lieutenant Governor Raymond. The latter, at the conclusion of the address, exclaimed to a friend, "I would give $20,000 if I could deliver that address in that manner." A man who came up from slavery, being the envy of politicians with his polished and beautiful speech. And just one more item here about his intellect, about his character, what was inside of him. If, as has been stated, his intellection is slow when unexcited, it is most prompt and rapid when he is thoroughly aroused. Memory, logic, wit, sarcasm, invective, pathos, and bold imagery of rare structural beauty well up as from a copious fountain, yet each in its proper place and contributing to form a whole, grand in itself, yet complete in the minutest proportions. It is most difficult to hedge him in a corner, for his positions are taken so deliberately that it is rare to find a point in them undefended aforethought. Professor Reason tells me of the following. On a recent visit of a public nature to Philadelphia and in a meeting composed mostly of his colored brethren, Mr. Douglas proposed a comparison of views in the matters of the relations and duties of our people, in quotes. He holding that prejudice was the result of condition and could be conquered by the efforts of the degraded themselves. A gentleman present, distinguished for long acumen and subtlety, and who had devoted no small portion of the last 25 years to the study and elucidation of this very question, held the opposite view, that prejudice is innate and inconquerable or unconquerable. He terminated a series of well-dovetailed Socratic questions to Mr. Douglas with the following. If the legislature at Harrisburg should awaken tomorrow and find each man's skin turned black and his hair woolly, what could they do to remove prejudice? Frederick Douglass's immediate response was, immediately pass laws entitling black men to all civil, political, and social privileges. This was the instant reply, and the questioning ceased. Thank you for listening.
Thanks, Dwight. That was really good.
Thank you, thank you.
I want to thank Tressa for joining us. And this has been really great for me. I had much fun. So Dwight, it's back over to you.
Well, Mike, it's back over to you.
So, okay, again, I agree with Emily. So I want to thank everybody for participating and for just being a part of this event. It's a very special event. It means a lot to me. It meant a lot to me last year to be a part of it. I taught school for 30 years, and every year I would bring out this sign, and it's offensive, and I'll just warn you, it's offensive. I would bring out this sign, and I would show it to my students, and I would let them know that this is not something, you know, that the one poem, the broken things, this is not something from the ancient past in our country. This is something from a generation ago. And there are still forces in our country, although there's been many bright spots, many wonderful things. And I've seen places where Dr. Martin Luther King's vision of a dream where white people and black people don't see each other and judge each other by virtue of the color of their skin. There have been some wonderful steps forward. We've had a black president. We have a black vice president. There are many, many wonderful artists and people that have pushed our culture in beautiful directions. But we should never forget that there are people who would still linger on this. There are people who, the fight is not over, the dream is not over. And we need to remind, and I'm especially saying this for Amelia's benefit, the young person joining us, she needs to know, we need to know the history. We need to recognize it. That's why we have a Black History Month. We need to recognize the reality and celebrate the accomplishment. If you haven't read the Time Magazine this month, it's fantastic. And it's not just Amanda Gorman, but it's filled with Black artists and Black intellectuals, people that have made wonderful accomplishments, who are speaking their voice and are out there. And I just wanted to read you, they do an interview in this with Amanda Gorman, and I just wanted to read you the last question and her answer. The question was, do you have any advice for young girls and Black girls in particular who earn their way into the spotlight? And she said this, "My question is, do they have any advice for me? I'm new to this. I'm still learning. I would say anyone who finds themselves visible and suddenly famous, makes me think of the Invisible Man story that was read today. Think about the big picture, especially for girls of color. We're treated as lightning or gold in a pan. We're not treated as things that are going to last. You really have to crown yourself with the belief that what I'm about and what I'm here for is way beyond this moment. I'm learning that I'm not lightning that strikes once. I am the hurricane that comes every single year, and you can expect to see me again soon." And I pray that all of us will take her words and become that hurricane, and that our voices would always be heard. Thank you again, everybody, for joining us. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and close our meeting. Thank you, Emma-Lisa, for everything you did today. We appreciate you hosting this.
Thank you.
Have a blessed rest of your day.
You too.